I will just allow you to say your name and say that you're present. Charles Davis, present.
Ralph Taylor, present.
Mike Suford, present.
Ellen Bogdan, present.
Brian Keely, present.
I show that we have a quorum, and we will open the meeting, or we will speak to the meeting, the minutes of the January meeting. Can I have a motion?
Mike Suford, I move to approve the minutes as printed.
Ralph Taylor, I second the motion.
All in favor, say aye. Roll call. Charles Davis, aye.
Ralph Taylor, aye.
Mike Suford, aye.
Ellen Bogdan, aye.
Brian Keely, aye.
Mary.
Can you push down the button on your microphone?
Yes, ma'am. I got it down.
Oh, my mistake, her fault. Okay.
So the minutes are passed.
Uh-huh.
The next thing on the discussion, the agenda, is the 2021-2022 AAP discussion. Do we need to close the meeting, or we're going to?
No, no.
Okay.
This isn't a hearing.
We're just going to keep going through this. This isn't a formal hearing, so.
I'll just turn it over to you then.
Okay, that'd be great. For Brian and Ellen, primarily, I wanted to explain that we do a five-year consolidated plan that kind of dictates what we do for those 5 years, what categories we can work in. And our plan, five-year plan, said we would do home repairs, demolition of dangerous structures. We get emergency solutions grant funds from the state to do homelessness prevention and rapid rehousing. We would do public service agency funding, home ownership assistance program. Institutional rehab is doing repairs to public service agency buildings. We said we were going to do program administration, which is funding my office. And then if we wanted to, we could always do what's called a substantial amendment and add other areas that we wanted to fund with CDBG funds. So that's kind of the areas that we have. What I wanted to discuss was whether or not you still see those as applicable for this last year of the five-year plan. And if there's something that's not in there or any of those categories that you wanted to discuss. I'll just let you know that in the past, we've been fortunate as a city to be able to fund home repair. A lot of cities don't fund that area, and that's for low, moderate income families that need health and safety repairs to their houses, usually a roof, a heating system. Right now, heating systems are going to be big. I expect in the next couple of days we'll get quite a few calls for heating systems. Also, plumbing, electrical, those kinds of things. So the ADA compliance, you know, for people who need ramps and so forth. So I've put most of our money in that category because I think that that's really important. And that's what we've talked about in the past. But if you think that we want to do that differently, I certainly can. The demolition of dangerous structures is something that the city manager and the city commission would like to see in the CDBG grant. So I put that in. The home ownership assistance I put in because The city is 50% rental, kind of like a college town, due to the fort. And so we try to encourage more ownership in the city. Institutional rehab, when I first started, the agency said that they would be interested in doing that, but they have to work with Davis-Bacon wages and all the Davis-Bacon compliance. And to be real honest, that has scared a lot of the smaller nonprofits off of doing that. And I don't really blame them. It's a lot of extra work, and unfortunately, there's nothing I can do about that because it's a federal government requirement. So we haven't had a lot of use in that category. We have used institutional rehab to do, we're doing a major sewer line. I don't know if you remember last year we put in the sewer line over on Olive. There's a sewer line from like 5th to 6th that needed to be redone, and all the people that are on that line are fit within our low moderate income guidelines. And the project was going to cost each family between $20,000 and $25,000, which is beyond most people's budget. It just was going to be a really expensive project. So we decided to do it as a CDBG project and absorb the cost of that. But I don't have another project like that from Public Works that I know of that's needed right at the moment. So that's enough of talking out of me. Anybody got any questions or want to talk about any of the categories?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
Ralph Taylor. What did I want to just know how much, once a person puts in for the home repair, low income or moderate, how long does that normally take once they get approved, or how long does it take them to get approved?
The approval we usually can process pretty fast. And we do it as a first come, first serve. So whenever they get their application in, if I'm getting a lot, there have been periods where I get a lot of applications at once. First one that comes in, we process that one, then we do the next one, the next one, the next one, the next one. Unless it's been deemed an emergency repair. And if it's like somebody doesn't have any heat today, that's an emergency. You can't be out there in 7-degree weather with no heat, you know, so we try to work pretty quick on those. And what we do is we move them to the head of the class, we qualify them income-wise and so forth, and we just bid out to one contractor to get it done. You know, we don't go through the entire bid process. We just try and get it done right away if it's an emergency. If somebody doesn't have any water, that's been another one. Or their sewer line broke and they don't the sewer no longer can be used, and that's another one. Those kinds of things where, you know, it affects their daily impact and their health and safety, we try to address those right away. The rest of them we do first come, first serve. We usually qualify them as fast as we can, so as long as they give us all the data that we're asking for, which is their, you know, verification of income, their last year's taxes. We have to check and make sure that they've owned the property for at least a year, those kinds of things.
About 20 items, isn't there?
Huh?
There's about 20 items.
There's a chunk, yeah. And so we do all those things, and Janine can process them in a couple of days, usually. And then what we have to do from that point is I go out with a building inspector, we check out the situation, we make sure that the house is in decent enough shape that we should invest in it. And usually there have only been a couple of times where we've had that as an issue. And then we will come back. I'll do what's called a work write-up. I'll write up what we think needs to be done for that property within the amount of money that we have available. And then we put it out to bid with companies that have basically pre-qualified with us, which means they have the insurance requirements that the city requires. They've done their affirmative action with the city manager's office. Those kinds of things. There are several steps that they need to do to be, they have to be, have a license with the city if it's a trade that needs a license like HVAC. So we make sure that they have all those things before we allow them to bid.
Okay, I understand.
And then, once we get the bids, go ahead.
Go ahead. I just have, you were answering the question I had about once you process and identify home repair, you go out and it needs to be done. Are these folks that you have approved, the city's approved to do work, are they all local businesses?
They're all metro local. Not all of them are just here in Leavenworth. We do advertise on a regular basis, at least once or twice a year, asking for tradespeople, and we have signs up in the inspection area saying that we're looking for people who want to work with our program. Some of them don't want to work with federal government funds, and I get that. I can't make them do that, but I also can't hire them if they don't do the things that we need to have done.
Thank you.
Yeah, and so if I had my druthers, I would prefer that they all be local, but in order to have enough people bidding, I do bid with some of the contractors that work for other CDBG programs in the metro area. And then my goal is to give them a time frame when we're going to be taking bids. After we get them in, then we'll, by federal government guidelines, we have to take the lowest bid. I contact the homeowner, make sure that they're comfortable with who we have selected. If they are, then the three of us enter into a business arrangement. Myself, representing the city, the contractor, and the homeowner. And so that way everybody's on the same page. It's worked out pretty well once we started taking the bid process in-house. Because they used to make the homeowner get the bids, and that was harder.
Yeah.
Especially for some of the older homeowners.
I gotta believe it was streamlined because you know what right looks like ahead of time.
Yeah, well, yeah, I'm getting there.
I know you spoke to institutional rehab being something that a lot of the institutions shy away from. And I know this to be a fact, but when you see that, you shift funds to other areas that need to be covered? Is that
something? Well, the first year that we awarded money in that category and they didn't use it, then we shifted money. Recently, I have not awarded money in that area.
Okay.
I haven't set it aside for that category. We could always move money over there if somebody came to us and said, we had a fire, we need, to do some institutional rehab. But those agencies that originally thought they wanted to use it decided that they might not really want to use it. And like I said, there are a lot of guidelines with Davis-Bacon that I understand they might not want to do.
So it's good to have there, just not necessarily setting it aside.
Right.
Specific amount.
Right. At this point, I think it's nice to have those things available just in case they want to be able to take advantage of them. If you guys are okay with those categories, I'll go ahead and kind of arbitrarily set it up similar to what we did this year. I don't know how much money we have yet, because the federal government is just trying to get its sea legs. So they haven't come up with our award yet, and that's typical for this time of year. They might not come up with our award until April. So what we do is we base it on what we were awarded last year. We hope for more. We pray not for less, and then we move forward. So that's kind of where that's at. I'll just base it off of last year unless anybody has anything else they'd like to discuss.
I don't have anything that I feel like that's a good plan.
Okay, all right. One thing I did want to discuss with you, is about the limit that we currently have for home repair. We currently have the upper limit for low-income families at $5,000 and the limit for moderate-income families at $3,000. And I feel like we set it at that because if you go over $5,000, you have to do lead-based paint remediation on the project, which just makes the project more complex and a little bit bigger, especially for some of the older houses that are here in town, because they have a lot of older peeling paint, and that requires some work. But I feel like the projects lately have gotten roofs. You can no longer get a roof for $5,000, even a small 800 square foot house. You can't get it for $5,000. And even some of the HVAC systems, if they have to replace the whole system, it's more than $5,000. So I was suggesting a possibility of increasing that up to $8,000 because you're going to need probably $6,000 or $7,000 to do the repair you need to do, plus at least $1,000 to do some of the lead-based paint stuff that you'll need to do.
And the lead-based paint, that's a federal guideline.
Federal guideline requirement,
and that's,
yes.
And that's based on that $5,000.
Yeah, they have not moved.
It's been that way a long time.
It has been that way for a very long time, and I kept thinking they would change it, and they just are not going to do it. So I just think at this point we should do it. I've been loaning money out of the Housing Trust Fund, which is a separate fund of money that I have, to those homeowners to be able to cover the extra $1,000 or whatever if they didn't have the money. But I'm doing that almost every project, and that's just indicates to me that it's probably time to raise that cap. So
do you think the $8,000 would be pretty much based on what you're lending money? You know, if you said you're lending money, would that $8,000 cover that, or should we go to $10,000?
We could go to $10,000, but then that moves us up into the lead-based paint. That's one more step that we have to go above. I think we could go right up to $10,000 if you wanted to do that.
I guess the question for me is where you were arrived at that $8,000 limit was based on your research.
I came up with $8,000 because I was trying to balance how many homes we would do versus what I see the costs coming in at right now. Right now, an HVAC system is running about $5,500 to $8,000, you know, somewhere in that range.
Mm-hmm.
And a roof is running between $5,000 and $7,000 for the house size that we are working with. So I thought that would be an okay number, but we could go bigger. We could go bigger.
We could do $175,000 project.
So that was my point was to that was if we leave it, if we raise it to 8 and not to 10, which is not a bad idea, but more people will be able to have opportunity at the 8,000 level.
Yeah.
Because if we do 10, then somebody down the line that may or may not have needed will not be able to do it because we've already given up 10 for each of these other projects.
Well, so, and I have to be honest, we have expended in the past, we have expended our full amount of money for repairs a couple of times, but not every year. I think if I do 25 houses, then we have expended most of what we've got. But we can also shift money between home ownership and home repair a certain amount. We can shift our funds if we need to. But if you would like to err on the side of caution and make it $10,000, I think we could do that.
Because there's no guarantee they're going to use all 10,000.
Well, they don't. Sometimes people say to me, well, we get to use the full $10,000. It's like, no, you get to do a project. We'll decide what's going to be done within that project. You know, I'm not going to spend.
They don't keep spending until they get the $10,000.
Yeah, you don't keep spending on a project until you
get. I want one of these. I want one of those. Feel much more. I feel a lot more comfortable with Ralph's suggestion that we raise it even that much more, and that way that those low income, it's raised up even what till 7? Are we? Is that what we're saying?
We're saying low income would be 10, and we're saying moderate income would be up to 7.
Yes. Yeah. Sorry, I apologize. Yeah, I got them flipped around.
And that's pretty much the way I was thinking. He just took my thought.
Okay, so, Ellen, can we hear from you what you think about that?
My first reaction was, correct me if I'm wrong, you said to bring it up to 8 originally, right?
I did, yes.
And from your experience, it's not going to matter because we can shift funds if we have more people in need.
Correct.
Okay. So what I'm asking is, if we raise it to 10, it is not going to necessarily impact some folks not getting taken care of.
I don't.
You're not going to spend the 10.
I don't believe so. No.
Oh. You don't believe so?
I don't believe it's going to impact people not being able to be served. I don't believe so, no. So I think we can serve everybody at 10,000 and 7,000 if we want to do that. I was just being more conservative in raising it just 3,000 instead of 5,000. So,
well, and in the past.
5,000 jump seems like pretty significant jump to me, but you all have been on this longer and are smarter than I am. But
well, ask questions. You're new.
That's a supposition on your part that we're smarter because we're definitely not smarter.
Hey, in the past with the home ownership and the repair program, most of the time, we either have homeowners or we're needing repairs. So we're able to float in between those two and keep a balance and serve everybody that's needed.
The thing that dictates whether we can move monies is our citizen participation plan says that we can't change a line item more than 50%. So we can't just take everything out of homeownership and move it to home repair, but we can move some monies around if we would like to do that. We almost never take anything, we never take anything out of public service agencies because we're only allowed to put 15% of the money there in the first place, which is a smaller pool of money, and all those agencies need the money. So that stays pretty much at that max cap. But between the two, homeownership and home repair, we can move some monies. I think that if you would like to move it $5,000, the advantage would be that you could do this one-time move and you wouldn't be changing it again in a couple of years. But like Ellen said, I thought $5,000 seemed like a pretty big jump from one to the other. So I just made it at $8,000.
I thought it was a big jump too.
Yeah.
But I also know we have confidence in...
$10,000 don't go far in home repairs.
We just have confidence in your ability to make sure that that's...
Well, and there are some projects. I have worked on some really tough projects, and they have been very low income and a lot of deferred maintenance, and they can't absorb another $5,000 worth of, even if I do a loan for them at $50 a month for the rest of a forever.
Yeah, and you felt handcuffed not being able to provide,
right.
Give that opportunity
right.
to them.
Right.
I understand that.
So I think we would use the $10,000 cap as something that we would internally do. We might not. I don't know if we would publish how much money we would be able to award or not.
That's the other question I had. I don't necessarily know that we would want to publish that, but offer it up when asked.
Yeah, I think that might be maybe the answer. What about you, Brian? What are you thinking?
Just correct me if I'm wrong, but it sounds like, I'm not saying it happens every time, but it can be considered typical of, if there's an overrun, the money comes from somewhere else anyway. Am I understanding that correctly?
Yes, but it's a loan, so they have to pay it back, which is a hardship, actually, for some of those families.
So if you raise the number, then it negates the loan on the individual?
Right. It would then just all be a grant.
Okay, yeah. And I would, raising it makes sense because it kind of just embraces the reality that costs are higher than what we've got, and if it ends up putting the onus on the person we're trying to help. And
yeah, that burden of that $50 a month for however long, it doesn't seem a lot to a lot of people, but to some people it might be overwhelming and tipping point, I guess is the word I'm looking for.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. I agree with it. So yeah, if you raise it, I don't know what the number to raise it to is. If it's 10, if it's 9,999, that keeps whoever away from the liability of having to abate lead paint, then yeah, that sounds good. But yeah, you also don't want to make it where you're doing more than what is actually needed, or not giving other people the benefit of the money. So I'm open to whatever dollar amount you say makes the most sense, because I just don't really have a good grip on what those costs are. But I think it does need to be raised based off what you're saying. I don't see the point of putting the loan back on those people that you're trying to help.
Okay. How about if we do a motion and a vote?
Before we do that, I wanted to thank everybody for their input on this. I know this is something that we probably didn't think a whole lot about, but I know we took some time to give it some real thought. And again, I appreciate that input, and I know Mary does as well.
I do.
Do I have a motion to raise the limit to $10,000 for low and $7,000 for moderate?
I'll make that motion.
I'll second that motion.
I'll do a roll call. Charles Davis, aye.
Ralph Taylor, aye.
Mike Seifert, aye.
Ellen Bogdan, aye.
Brian Keeley, aye.
Motion passes. Raising the limit to $10,000 and $7,000.
Okay. The next thing I wanted to do was explain kind of how our next committee meeting, our board meeting will be. We ask public service agencies to apply to us for funding through CDBG. And I send out the application in January. I just got them Friday was the deadline. And each board member gets a packet of all the applications that we got. You're supposed to do a rating sheet on each one of those public service agencies. The maximum number of points for each category is over on the side. And you can give the full number of points, you can give a partial number of points, and then there's a total down at the bottom. I take each of your totals for each of those agencies and aggregate them and come out with the information so that we can have that at the next board meeting when the agencies come to present their requests. They'll come to our board meeting probably virtually this year. That's a time for any board member to ask any questions that they have. Maybe there's something that you see about their program you want to know more about. Maybe there's something about their budget you want to know more about. We award funds for rent or utilities, depending on whether or not they're renting their facility. Some of them own their own facilities, so we pay utilities for those agencies. Some of them rent their facility, so we pay rent up to whatever amount we award. So it may be that, let's say, for example, we award them $5,000 and their utilities are $1,000 a month. Well, obviously, we aren't going to be paying all of their utilities, but we'll pay them up to that amount. So that's kind of how we have had it structured in the past. I was going to change that this year, but I just feel like the agencies have had so much to do this year that changing it would not be appropriate at this point. So whoever fills in for me after I retire, they're going to have to take on changing that part. They're going to be in charge of that. Ellen and Brian, I primarily went over this for the two of you because the other three have gone through this process before. Do you have any questions that I can answer for you about what we'll do at our next board meeting on the 8th of March?
No, I'm clear. Thank you.
Okay. I do have...
Good.
Are you good, Brian?
Yeah. Yes. Yes, I am.
Okay, great. I do have the packets ready for you to pick up at any time. You don't have to rush right over and get them because you have the full month to get them done. But I will send you an email reminder that the packets are available and also for those other board members that are not here. For the three of you that are here, I did bring them down for you. So we're good. I just say, you know, when the weather gets a little better and I would say warmer, but it doesn't sound like it's going to do that anytime soon, but at least the streets get clearer. That would be good. I have not scanned these documents yet, but if it is hard for you to get down here to get them, I will be glad to scan them and email them to you. So whatever we can do to make this work for those of you who are not here, I would be glad to do that, okay? I think that's all
sounds good.
Okay, I think that's all I had to say about the public service agency funding. You will notice that they request quite a bit of money, more than we usually award. I think that just indicates what the demand is out there, but unfortunately, the federal government just allows us 15% of our overall award to go to public service agencies. So sometimes we divvy it up the best we can, and hope to serve the best good we can with the amount of money we've got.
I wanted to, you have something?
No, I'm okay with that.
Okay.
So I have a point of order, I guess.
Yes.
So based on, I know we got the packets. Is there, do you think it's possible for you to, I don't want to say walk us through, but like a typical grading system? Like you said, I know that Mike and I have done this for a couple of years now, and Ralph is at least one grading system in. So, but and I want to make sure, because I mean, even though I've done it several times, it still is a little baffling as to what right looks like, you know.
Okay.
You know what, and if I hope I'm not trying to belabor the point, but I think that's something that Ellen and Brian would be okay with.
Oh boy, I don't have a way to bring this up on the computer, unfortunately.
Blame me.
Yeah, I don't think flashing it in front of you is going to work very well. But there's one, two, three, four areas that you judge. One is need. Does the applicant provide convincing reasons why the project should be funded? Does it meet the strategic priority of the city of Leavenworth, which we determined was housing, food, and health? So those three categories. And this is all written on the grading sheet that you'll have. And there's like a couple of bullet points that just kind of help you, prompt you to think about the particular applicant.
As you're looking through their packet.
As you're looking through their packet. And then for need, we say that can be worth up to 30 points. So in the grayed out box, if you think they 100% do great work in the community, they have a lot of need, you can look at their budget sheet and you can see that they have need for funds, and they demonstrate that their need is not currently or adequately being met through existing programs. So say they're doing food and they are not being able to serve as many people as they had planned to, or not to the level that they had hoped to be able to assist. Perhaps that's something that we would want to award full 30 points to.
Understand.
Okay. So then the next one is the project. So is the project clear and specific? Are its beneficiaries and outputs described? Is it realistic and measurable and achievable? Are what they say they're going to do, is it something we think they can actually accomplish? Can it be accomplished within the year that we're talking about funding them for? And do they have good criteria for evaluating how they are gonna do that project, how they're gonna serve people? Do they have a good way to evaluate that and make sure that they're doing the best job that they can? Now, for project, we said that that's worth 20 points. Okay, so a maximum of 20 points. Maybe you think that they don't really have a good way to measure whether they're doing a good job. In the materials that they give you, they don't really talk about that, they whatever. So, but you think that their objectives are really clear and you think that the information is really clear. So maybe in that category, you would give them 15 points. You know, it's a
subjective,
looking at all those bullet points and figuring out where you think that they fall within the marker. Then budget and timeliness, are they, does their budget look like they know what they're doing with funds? Does their audit, if they had to have an audit, does their audit say that, you know, everything's going okay? For those that don't have to do an audit, they have to provide us their 990. And so that's a government form that you fill out, and it kind of addresses their funding in that way. That's usually smaller nonprofits. We can't make them do an audit, and there's no sense making them do an audit if they're a small enough agency that they don't need to do an audit. And then the last one is performance measures. Does the net results for the project serve the low moderate income community? Are they serving the community that we're supposed to be serving with our dollars? I mean, that's our primary goal with these HUD dollars, is serving the low moderate income community in a variety of ways. And we've decided our variety of ways is housing, food, and health. So are they doing that? And the performance measures, you know, their actual accomplishments based on prior grants, based on prior information that they're giving us. If they're a new, we don't have any new agencies that applied this year, but, you know, I think it's important that these grant funds do what they say they're going to do, and that they have a measurable, accomplishable results. So, and then at the end, you take the different categories and how you've scored them, and then you come up with a total.
And they'll use that to account for all those and make sure from highest to lowest.
Right.
Score.
And so what I'll do is I'll say, well, Ralph gave Group A a 50, and Charles gave Group A a 75, and Mike gave Group A a 30, and I'll put all the different scores that we have so that you can see them, and then the average of those scores to help you look at the different agencies and kind of how, as a group, you rated those agencies. Just as a tool for you to help decide how you want to award the funds.
And this is the best way to grade those agencies with this scoring.
I don't know if it's the best. It's been a way.
Well, yeah, no, working. I was just saying. No, that was the thought. There was that we've taken what other cities have used in order.
It's evolved. I borrowed this from the city of Overland Park.
Yeah,
they have been doing this kind of a more measured. When I got here, there was no measured objective on how we were doing this. We were just doing it, and I felt like if an agency was unhappy about what we awarded or that we didn't award them, we needed to be able to provide reasons.
Absolutely.
And so what I wanted was some tool from my board that said, well, you know, it seemed like you didn't score well in this particular category. Now, we don't have to tell them how to fix that category, but I do think it's important that we give them some feedback so that they can reapply if they would like to. And we have, in the time that I've been here, we have not awarded some applications, or we've not awarded them to the level that made them happy. But I think that this tool helps. And I would be glad for any suggestions to make it better, because I'm always about trying to make things better. So if, while you're doing this, you don't think it works, I think as a board, we should discuss it and we should change it. Because just because I borrowed it from somebody doesn't mean it's the best way to do it. Some of the other systems that I looked at, like Independence and stuff, they were more complicated. And I don't always think more complicated is better, but they're dealing with much more money too.
I understand that.
They're dealing with, like, giving away our full budget just in,
have a larger population base.
They have a larger population base, so they're awarded more money, so they have more money that they can do public service with. Same thing with Kansas City, same thing with KCK. They just have so much more money that they have to ask more questions and do more due diligence than we do. So this was the more, it provided some feedback, but it was streamlined, I guess, is what I thought was.
Without naming names, can you point, or can you say there's an agency or agencies that have taken your feedback and improved on theirs to the point where you know, it's noticeable, and that the next year they came back with, you know, with pass with flying colors, if you will?
I have met with agencies to discuss their applications, and they have made changes. I'll say that. I think it's smart if you're going to ask for feedback to be ready to do that feedback.
Oh, absolutely. You know? Yeah, I can imagine.
So there have been times. And I also, last year I did not do this for the first year since I've been here, but I usually do some kind of general monitoring with each of the agencies to look at their operations, their staffing, to talk to them about how things are, and to try and help them improve or answer questions about just general, you know, questions about running a nonprofit, because HUD feels like our job is to help strengthen those agencies. And I look at their finances, and sometimes I say, you know, this isn't the way you need to be doing this. You know, I had one agency that when I got there, they were doing all their budgeting in their checkbook ledger. Well, that's okay if you're a small agency, that's okay, but it's not going to do in terms of applying for federal funds. You know, you're going to need to have a spreadsheet, and you're going to need to be able to show where all your money goes and where the federal money went. So they took that to heart, and they, you know, they got QuickBooks, and they're off and running. So it's not because of me necessarily, but I think that oftentimes agencies are working really hard, and if there's a way that they can do things better, they're usually interested in listening to that.
Well, I think you're being modest, but we'll take all that into.
I'm not being modest. I just think that they always want to do a good job. Sometimes they don't know how to do a good job.
I appreciate you breaking that all down for us. And again, for Ellen and Brian, I know that's something that scoring is, again, it can be.
The first year is the volunteers are up.
What's that?
The first year is the volunteers are up.
Yeah.
Yeah, the first year is the volunteers are up. No, it's not hard, but it is a little complicated, I think, to understand how to do the scoring. So
you almost feel like you're being too rough on some, and then you're like, God. You know, you find yourself second guessing. So, you know, the scores come in, you're like, did I completely mess somebody over? But I know you take the time and make sure that if there's something, a score that's completely here or completely there, those almost don't count because, you know, we may not, you know.
Well, and I think that's the advantage in averaging.
Yeah.
You know, and somebody may notice something in a particular agency and maybe somebody else didn't notice that thing. Yeah. And so it helps balance that out, I think. We all bring strengths to this job, and some of you may have stronger finance backgrounds, and some of you may have stronger backgrounds in volunteering. Maybe you volunteer for several agencies, and you understand how they function. And so I think that helps everybody bring their strengths into working on this board. Then when we evaluate the different, I would say the most important thing to do is to read all the applications first. I always read all of them first, and then I go back and score everybody. Because that way I know what I'm comparing apples to apples.
And
you know, for that particular year. So I think that helps.
I do appreciate that.
Not a problem. Anything for anybody else? All right, well, primarily this was just a planning meeting. The next one will be a public meeting. The public can participate, the agencies will participate, and of course the board will participate. So we'll get that all set up and look forward to having everybody here. Thank you very much for your time today, and thank you very much for participating on this really cold day. So
do I have a motion to adjourn?
I move to adjourn.
Also second.
Second.
Brian seconds.
Brian seconds it. Roll call.
Either or.
I'll take roll call. Charles Davis, aye.
Ralph Taylor, aye.
Mike Seifert, aye.
Ellen Bogdan, aye.
Brian Keeley, aye.
Motion carries. We are adjourned.
Thank you, everyone.